I have commanded men in battle. So it's with a soldier's eye that I'm going to re-examine what happened on the Somme. The greatest test of my experience came during Britain's war with Argentina over the Falkland Islands, where I was a brigade commander. Then I had to make life and death decisions from, some might say, the relative safety of my command post. It's the job of a battlefield commander to send men to kill and perhaps to be killed, to achieve the aims of his ultimate masters, the politicians who may be thousands of miles away. A general gives orders, but he carries out instructions too. That's why I'm fascinated by this battle and how it's perceived today. It's hard to visualize the scale and ferocity of the fighting. Just on day one, there were 58,000 casualties, 19,000 of them killed. To put that in context, it's more than five times the total Allied ground force casualties on D-Day in World War II. During my command in the Falklands, I was under no illusions that casualties must be minimized. Not just because that's the aim of any humane commander, but because of how it would play for the public and the politicians. The Somme was different, but not because British generals were incompetent or inhumane. I will examine why it proved so costly, how vast an operation it was in men and materiel, and in doing so, confront some of the myths that have developed over the years. The Somme region of France, roughly 100 miles due north of Paris, takes its name from the meandering River Somme. The gently rolling downland, dotted with small villages, looks much like a piece of England. Young British soldiers, most of them on foreign soil for the first time, felt strangely at home here. Peaceful now. On the morning of Saturday, July the 1st, 1916, this was a scene of massive activity, of excitement, probably of fear too, as 750,000 men waited for 0 hour to approach. So what were the British trying to achieve? That's as good a question today as it was 90 years ago. The battle was forced on the British, not by their enemies, but by their allies, the French. As 1916 approached, there was a crisis brewing in the Allied high command, with the French CNC, General Joseph Joffre, demanding that the British get stuck in on the Western Front. So far, it had been the French who'd been doing most of the fighting and most of the dying.
In the whole of the war, with a population 7 million less than the British, the French have twice as many military deaths. So they have lost an awful lot of men. The French have a huge army compared to the British. The British army is regular, it's all volunteer, it's tiny, it's an imperial gendarmerie. The French have got universal military service. Now, they are constantly accusing the British of not pulling their weight. They are saying to the British, why aren't you getting involved in offensives? You're not attacking enough. British riposts that there were 2 million sailors in the Royal Navy keeping the sea safe for all the Allies really wasn't of much concern to the French. And certainly the battles that the British had taken part in to us were enormous. The Battle of Loos in September 1915 was a big thing. To the French, it was a mere skirmish. We were using one army. They had five armies involved in Artois and Champagne. So as far as they were concerned, they've got to push out the German invader. If they don't, the government will fall. The British would have preferred to wait, build up their army, train their army, equip their army, and then, when everything was ready, strike a blow that will end the war.
Britain argued that it would be madness to rush raw recruits into the front line before they were trained. But what the French planned for them was even worse. Joffre wanted the Somme to be what he called a bataille d'azur, a battle of attrition. He promised 40 French divisions, that's 500,000 men, who would have outnumbered the British at the Somme by nearly 2-1. And the battle would commence in August 1916. In blunt terms, it would be a killing match, the aim to lock horns with the Germans and kill as many as possible.
It's the French concept of attrition, let's just kill Germans, and if they killed 1 million Germans and the Germans killed 1 million minus one Frenchman, then the French win. Now, winning by one wicket has never been part of the British way of waging war. That's not the way we fight wars. We can't afford these huge casualties. We don't do that. We will try and take objectives that can be taken. And effectively, the two do diverge at this point.
The general, given the task of managing the greatest British offensive of the war so far, was this man, Sir Douglas Haig. Often accused of being the principal donkey, the judgment of history can be fickle.
Haig has been grossly maligned. I mean, this is the man who took a tiny British army, had to deploy it, train it, fight it, until in 1918 it's the only army on the Western Front capable of defeating the Germans militarily in the field. It's Haig's army that does it, it's Haig's victory. And at the end of the war, everybody believed it was Haig's victory, both the public and his soldiers. And indeed, when he died, several hundred thousand of his old soldiers marched past the body. He was revered, he was seen as the man who'd won the war.
Haig didn't believe this was the right time to throw his men into battle, nor the right place. There were far better strategic targets elsewhere. At this point in the war, German U-boats posed the greatest threat to Britain's survival by threatening to cut her shipping lifeline, bringing food and war materials from overseas. If the U-boat bases in Belgium could be overrun, it would strike a major blow. What would winning ground here on the Somme achieve? Pretty well nothing. So why did Haig attack here? All generals, then and now, have to serve political masters. Haig was under orders to keep the French on side. After February 1916, he was left with no choice but to obey. It was then that the Germans launched their own massive assault on the fortress city of Verdun. The Germans' declared aim was to bleed France white by forcing her to pour troops into the defense of Verdun. Now the French insisted that Haig must attack as soon as possible on the Somme to draw off German forces from Verdun. But instead of 40 divisions, the French could only spare 5. And the August start date must be pulled forward to June or July at the latest. And so the scene was set for the Battle of the Somme, a battle to be fought for uncertain strategic reasons, probably in the wrong place and arguably at the wrong time. This is where the killing match would be staged. The front line ran between the towns of Albert, Bapaume and Peronne, with the Germans holding the area to the north and east. The British, with 22 divisions, would attack in the northern sector, with 5 French divisions to the south. A front of 25 miles in total. Almost everywhere, the old trenches have long ago been ploughed under. One small section of trench lines has been preserved, near Beaumont Hamel. Scars in the earth, which are still a powerful reminder of July the 1st, 1916. At 7:30, the whistles blew and they climbed out of this trench. One of the most enduring and heart-rending images of this battle is of young men walking slowly forward into withering machine gun fire and being slaughtered. So did the British soldiers simply walk from the trench lines here towards the enemy over there through withering machine gun fire? The answer, surprisingly, is yes. That's one of the legends that is true. In this situation, you really have three options. You run, walk, or crawl. The distance from the British trenches to the German front line here was about 1/4 mile. Sometimes it could be up to 1 mile or more. Could I, even in my younger days, have run uphill 1 mile, carrying 70 pounds of kit, over ground churned up by shell fire, and still been fit to fight on arrival? The answer is no. And so the troops were ordered to take it easy at the beginning and save their energy for a last-minute dash when close to the German trenches. So why didn't they crawl and present less of a target to the machine guns? Once the British appeared, the whole of this area was under intense German artillery fire. Shrapnel shells bursting overhead, trench mortars. They were letting off everything they'd got. The less time spent crawling through the killing zone, the better. And the closer you got to the German trenches, the less chance you had of being hit by German shells. It wasn't blinkered stupidity that led commanding officers to order the men to walk forward. It was deemed to be the safest thing to do.
We know what killed people. We know from the medical reports and from the casualty returns. And in fact, it's a minority that are killed by bullets. It's about 39% of all British deaths are caused by small arms bullets. Now, that's either rifle or machine gun. We don't know which. The overwhelming number of deaths are caused by artillery, and that's about 58%. That's what does the killing. This is an artillery war.
What made it so difficult for those attacking rather than those defending? The Germans had dug in first, way back in 1914. That gave them a huge advantage. They'd bagged the best spots. Just as I would, they looked for the dominating ground, the easily defended village, the wood providing cover for artillery. British trenches were dug second, in effect laying siege to the enemy. In some sectors, when they finally captured the German trenches, the British were horrified to see how overlooked their positions had actually been. Why were the German defences so strong and so deadly? They'd been subjected to massive bombardment since the 24th of June. A staggering 1,700,000 shells were fired in total from more than 2,500 guns. The barrage went on round the clock at a rate of nearly 3 shells a second, night and day. The thunder of the guns was audible in London, 180 miles away. The list of targets for pounding had been meticulously prepared. Not only the German front-line trenches, but also their second and third-line defences, as well as supply routes and stores. For targeting particular strong points, there were huge 12-inch naval guns, built for a battleship but converted for mounting on a rail platform. Hurling a shell weighing 1,400 pounds a distance of 12 miles. At the other end of the scale, there were what the troops called plum puddings, 2-inch trench mortars, firing a bomb weighing 60 pounds. You can see from the upright angle of the firing tube that it's meant to drop on a trench, probably no more than 400 yards away. Never before in military history had there been a bombardment of this intensity. The entire Allied battle plan was based on the concept that the artillery would give the Germans such a mauling that the troops would merely have to mop up. Why wasn't that the case? The answer lies here. The underlying geology of the Somme makes it a nightmare for a general planning an assault. Chalk is perfect for deep dugouts, capable of resisting the heaviest artillery fire. All along the Somme front, the Germans were in effect defending a chain of subterranean forts some 30 feet deep. No evidence of them has survived, but it is possible to see what a British chalk dugout was like. A section of frontline trench near the village of Tiepval is currently being restored to the condition it was in on July the 1st, 1916. It's from here that men of the Ulster Division sprang forward on the morning of the attack.
We have a brigade commander's bunker here.
So, in fact, it shows that brigade commanders didn't live in chateaux.
Well, they weren't very far behind the front line. We're only maybe less than 70 metres behind the front line here.
They were pretty big, weren't they? I mean, they could have two or three tier bunks in them.
Oh, yes, show. Yes, oh,
yeah,
yes.
And office tables and the whole lot.
You can see where it's going to come through here.
Yeah.
Into the communication trench.
It must have taken quite an effort to dig a trench like this using only hand tools, because they didn't have JCBs in
those
days.
No, they didn't.
So how long would it have taken?
Well, the chalk at this level is not solid chalk. It's only when we go down probably another 5 or 6 feet that we go into solid chalk that you really get into the quarrying part of it. It's pretty fragmented chalk at this level, and although it would have been a very difficult and hard job for them to do it, it's not as difficult as it gets
lower when you go further down.
As you go further down.
The Germans had nearly 2 years to dig deep. The bombardment caused far less damage than the British hoped, largely because of those deep German bunkers dug into the chalk. Even worse, the barbed wire defences were still mainly intact. One of the key aims of the bombardment had been to tear apart the wire protecting the German trenches. There were two techniques: shrapnel, shells that burst in the air, spraying down hundreds of little metal balls to cut the wire, or high explosive shells, which blew up after landing. What determines how and when a shell explodes is this, the fuse, which sits on the nose of the shell. As a gunner, I can adjust it to make it explode in the air, on contact with the ground, or having drilled its way deep into the ground first. The air-bursting shrapnel shells, designed to kill troops in the open, proved ineffective at cutting wire. The high-explosive shells buried themselves in the ground, causing little damage to the wire above. What was needed was a shell that exploded immediately on contact in the ground, using what was called a graze fuse. Although there were some of these in service, many were defective, exploding prematurely and sometimes killing the gunners. Better graze fuse shells were developed later, but not in time to prevent the slaughter on the wire that morning. Far too many of the British shells at the Somme, around 30%, didn't explode at all. They were poorly manufactured, duds. Those plum puddings, the trench mortars, were notorious. On one occasion, the Germans raised a blackboard reading, "Should we send back your unexploded ammunition?" Farmers on the Somme regularly plough up unexploded shells to this very day. How far should the generals be blamed for equipment failure? When I was issued with kit for my troops, I expected it to have been field tested and to work. But good ideas on paper often fail in battle. The troops going over the top that morning carried a strange-looking gadget on the end of their rifles.
We've got the rifle, that's the short magazine Lee Enfield, and especially for the day, got a pair of wire cutters fixed. What happens is you push the wire cutters against the wire, and as these pull back, little levers close up and those jaws clamp around the wire, and that should snip neatly through the wire. It works brilliantly on British wire, just doesn't cut German wire.
It's impossible to judge how well the British generals performed or understand why controversial decisions were made without considering the huge scale of the operation, both in manpower and material.
People always take great interest in the actual fighting. They think that Tommy with his bayonet, that's what it's all about. But actually, you can have the best troops in the world, superbly equipped, brilliantly led, wonderfully trained. But if you can't move them and feed them and resupply them and tend to them when they're sick, you can achieve absolutely nothing. And successful generals are those that understand logistics.
The logistics behind the Somme campaign were complex and brilliantly handled. Establishing the army on the Somme was rather like, in population terms, creating a city the size of Edinburgh. Once everything arrived in France, the problems were just beginning.
Now we are accustomed to think of helicopters and great columns of lorries and track resupply vehicles and all the rest of it. At this period, we haven't yet got a pneumatic tyre, so you have not got a cross-country capability for a wheeled vehicle. So if you want to resupply your army and move all the kit that you need for a huge offensive like the Somme, when you're moving up shells, rations, water, railway track, gravel for roads, all sorts of kit, you're down to horse-drawn, mule-borne transport. The British Army was buying horses all over the world, it was buying mules. The British Army bought something like 400,000 mules as transport animals. 25% of all the shipping coming from England to the Western Front was fodder for all these animals that are pulling your transport wagons and your ambulances and your ammunition columns and everything else. You're actually shipping a greater weight of equine fodder than you are weight of shells.
What about the men? In crude terms, the quality of the human material the generals had to work with. Haig's troops were the product of a hastily organised training programme, designed to turn civilians into soldiers in the shortest time possible. The British Army in 1914 was geared up to recruit and train 30,000 new men every year. Once the call went out for volunteers, the army received 30,000 men in a single day, more than a million in total. It would be like the modern British Army expanding more than tenfold, almost overnight. Unlike the Germans, with 2 years' battle experience, the men Haig commanded at the Somme were for the most part going into action for the first time. Their enthusiasm was beyond question. Their competence would only be rarely tested once the bullets and shells started flying. Would we have won in the Falklands if my men were all essentially amateurs? Probably not. In one branch of warfare, sometimes overlooked in this battle, Haig's men proved to be the best in the business. Long before zero hour, another extraordinary aspect of this battle was already being played out, deep beneath where I'm now standing. While the Germans were being pounded by shells from above, a top-secret operation was underway to attack them from below. Here again, Allied commanders were pushing the boundaries of warfare with offensive mining on a scale never seen before. The mines required digging tunnels snaking towards the enemy trench line, often 50 to 100 feet deep, and stretching for hundreds of yards. At the Somme, there were 17 such tunnels. A chamber was hacked out at the end of the tunnel, into which was packed thousands of sacks of an explosive called ammonal. A team, including ex-military engineers, are exploring remaining British tunnel systems in northern France, exactly like those cut beneath the Somme in 1916.
We're now about 70 feet underground, and this tunnel we're in at present runs parallel to and just ahead of the front line. And off the tunnel, as you see, there are tunnels running towards the German lines, which are there. We're entirely in chalk. The geology here is deep and hard chalk. The underlying principles of the structure are much the same.
Building them took great courage and enormous effort.
There were something like 30,000 miners in the mining companies, three Canadian, three Australian, one New Zealand tunnelling company, and the remainder were British. In addition to those miners, there would be perhaps 500 infantry attached to every mining company when it was operating. So you're talking of, at any point of time, perhaps 50,000 men engaged in mining, and the logistic effort was enormous. So the timber needed, the explosives and moving the spoil, etc.
It was vital to keep the location of the tunnel's secret right up to 0 hour. Dumping a huge pile of chalk removed from the tunnels anywhere near the entrance would be spotted right away by the Germans.
So they had to remove this well away from the lines and conceal it. They bring it out of the tunnels in sandbags generally, onto light railways and move it back to perhaps old quarries where it could be concealed. Or they would put it into shell holes, cover over the top with topsoil. They had to hide it.
The location of the mines remained a secret, right up until the moment of detonation. Set for exactly 7:28. 2 minutes before the troops would go over the top. These mine craters, now filled by water, on a northern section of the old front line, give some idea of the size of the explosions which resulted. On the Somme, the craters from July the 1st have since been filled in. All except one.
This is the Loch Nagar crater, the largest of the mines blown that day, using 60,000 pounds of ammonal. Imagine the terror and confusion among the German defenders as thousands of tons of earth and chalk were blown into the sky and crashed down again, leaving a hole 80 feet deep and 300 feet across.
The huge mining operation, carried out in secret, just yards from the enemy, was a brilliant stroke which caused, as intended, massive casualties on the German side. But one mine was to cause a greater loss to the Allies than the Germans. The Hawthorne mine, near Beaumont Hamel, and containing 40,000 pounds of ammonal, was detonated early, 10 minutes before 0 hour. The plan was that troops would race forward to occupy the crater. In reality, the Germans got there first.
Perhaps the greatest tragedy of the entire day occurred when the Newfoundland Regiment was sent in to try to dislodge them. This unit of roughly 800 men was virtually wiped out.
Most died not as they came face to face with the Germans, but before they'd even reached the British front line. Because the communication trenches behind the front line were blocked by dead and wounded, they were forced to approach above ground and were mown down by German machine gunners
at something like half a mile range. It demonstrates the degree of confusion which exists on any battlefield, but also the lethal power of the weaponry in use on the Somme, above all, the machine gun. The British called it a Vickers gun, the Germans a Spandau, but both were only minor variations on the Maxim gun, invented by the American Hiram Maxim. A working Vickers gun is now incredibly rare, but the British Army has one. Apart from bullets, the most important bit of kit is water for the barrel's cooling jacket. It quickly boils, turns to steam, and is recycled via this hose. 100 yards for this weapon is point-blank range.
Do you want to go, sir?
The rate of fire is 500 rounds a minute.
Lift the check levers in your own time.
So despite what you hear, it's discharging around 9 bullets per second.
And again.
When you see this gun being fired in the movies, you often see them firing it looking like that and firing tiny little short bursts. That's quite wrong. The proper way to fire this gun is looking over the top and looking at the fall of shot, if you can see it, because you may be firing at ranges beyond which you can see, shooting off a map, i.e. getting a map, working out where the target is, taking a bearing to it, and laying the gun along that bearing. I was taught on this gun, because it was still in service when I was a young officer, you lift the lever, press the firing button, and you count one banana, two banana, three banana, four, which gives you a 4-second burst. You then hit it like that, and you're trained to do it, so you knock the gun off half a degree. Why? Because you're covering what is known as the beaten zone in that way. And you do it again after the next burst, and then back again. You can see how close together that fall of shot is on this target. This is because when I was firing, I was only 100 yards away. At about a mile and a half, that would spread out and produce this banana-shaped beaten zone, much bigger than this target here. 2 or 4 or 8 or 10 guns firing together will cover a huge beaten zone with interlocking zones of fire, which is why this gun was such a lethal weapon. The Germans will certainly have mapped out where the British would attack from months in advance and simply fired on those bearings on July the 1st. Because of the weapon's range, most machine gunners on both sides never even saw the men they were killing. The men who died never knew who was firing at them.
Given that both sides are essentially using the same sort of kit, and the only way you can defeat an enemy is capturing the ground that he's sitting on, that means that you have to cross open ground. And the way to do that without losing casualties will not come along for another 40 years, when eventually an armoured personnel carrier is produced. We don't have that in 1916. We don't have any means of protecting the soldier from the time our own artillery barrage lifts to our man getting into the enemy trench. That's the bit of ground that he's got to cover. He's got nothing to cover him. You're going to have casualties.
How much did the generals actually know about what was happening once the troops disappeared over the top? In the Falklands, I was in constant touch with the units forward, as well as those further back, providing fire support, either artillery or aircraft. Nowadays, it's not uncommon for a general to be watching live video pictures relayed from the battle area. Here, communications were unbelievably primitive by modern standards.
It's the only war where the commander cannot influence what is happening in real time by his voice. In previous wars, he could see what happens. In future wars, he's got a radio which gives him information in real time. He doesn't have that this time. And the main means of communication is by telephone. Just for the Somme alone, they lay something like 50,000 miles of telephone cable. I mean, that's nearly twice around the world. Huge numbers.
Beyond the front line, the telephone was virtually useless. Troops would trail wires behind them, but they were quickly severed by shellfire. The defenders didn't have that problem, so they could order up an artillery strike or reinforcements in an instant. As quaint as it sounds, the assault forces relied on carrier pigeons. Thousands of birds were held ready in mobile pigeon lofts like this. Just how primitive communications were is revealed by these pictures of men about to attack with something strange on their backs.
This rather odd tin triangle, every soldier in the 8th Corps had them. It's a piece of tin from a ration tin, and this will glitter, showing observers watching from the rear how far forward you've got. Remember, there's no telephones that you can take easily, and certainly no radios. This is very important to avoid being targeted by your own artillery.
The death toll on the Somme was so high because the technology of killing had far outstripped the technology of communication. I wonder how well commanders would have performed in the Second World War, or indeed today, if their communication was still by pigeon post. What was the position as the first day of the battle drew to a close? In the southern sector, the British and French had advanced up to a mile and a half, achieving many of their objectives. Further north, the picture was more bleak, with only very limited advances here, north of Thiepval. Almost 20,000 deaths made this the bloodiest day in the history of the British Army. And this was just the beginning. It's sometimes forgotten that the Somme wasn't a one-day battle, but a four-month campaign, lasting until November. The carnage of day one was never repeated, but the casualties rose remorselessly. Much of the fighting centered on the frontline villages, which were quickly reduced to nothing more than rubble. Here at Pozières, the Australian 1st, 2nd and 4th Divisions were engaged in the most bitter combat. They took the village with vicious hand-to-hand fighting among the ruined houses and cellars. In seizing Pozières, crucial as the highest vantage point on the whole battlefield, the Australians were to lose 23,000 men in 6 weeks, almost as many as fell at Gallipoli over 8 months. Everywhere, the Germans held the advantage of the defender, inside their dugouts and concrete bunkers like these. Faced with staggering losses for so little gain, should Haig have called a halt? Even if he'd wished to shut the battle down, such a decision wouldn't have been sanctioned by the French or indeed the British cabinet. And although the Allies weren't to know it at first, the battle had very quickly achieved its key strategic objective. On July the 12th, the German High Command called off the offensive at Verdun and rushed troops to deal with a new crisis on the Somme. From this point on, Verdun became a story of German retreat and French advance. The French wouldn't be knocked out of the war. But as summer turned to autumn, was there anything Haig could do to deliver a knockout blow on the Somme? Although he's sometimes been portrayed as a hidebound ex-cavalry officer, he championed Britain's revolutionary secret weapon. So secret that it had to be shipped to the front in giant sealed wooden boxes, labelled water tanks. The name stuck. The tank made its world debut on the field of battle here in and around the village of Fleur on September the 15th. Hay could ask for 150 tanks to be ready for day one of the Somme. If they had been, the results might have been very much different. As it was, 49 tanks were delivered in mid-September. Top speed was 3.7 miles an hour, not much more than walking pace. It was so noisy inside that the commander and his seven crew had to use hand signals. The crew risked serious injury just from the way they lurched around, and the armor was so thin that even machine gun bullets could do serious damage. But for crushing barbed wire, providing an element of cover for the infantry, and simply demoralizing the enemy, they proved very effective. At Fleur, terrified Germans surrendered in large numbers as the lumbering monsters arrived. A highly coloured account appeared in the British press. A tank is walking up the high street of Fleur with the British army cheering behind. Haig immediately placed an order for another 1,000 tanks to be delivered as soon as possible.
The tank is first used on the Battle of the Somme. It has some psychological effect on the Germans, but most of the initial batch that were used broke down, were knocked out, went on fire, got into shell holes and couldn't get out again. But people could see the potential. Taking the lessons of the use of tanks on the Somme, as time goes on, they get better and better and better. By 1917, they're quite useful. By the end of the war, the British are very good at the use of tanks.
As winter approached, heavy rain turned the battlefield into a quagmire. But the fighting continued. The last major attacks were mounted in October and November. It's remarkable to note that Beaumont Hamel was one of the objectives marked down for capture on the first day of the battle. It was finally taken by the 51st Highland Division on November the 14th. July the 1st seemed a very long time ago. The Battle of the Somme officially ended on November the 19th. The actual advance made by the Allies amounted to 9 miles at its deepest. But it's crucial to understand that winning ground wasn't the main aim of this battle. Haig's final dispatch reflects his orders that keeping France in the war was the real task. So, who won the Battle of the Somme? An officer of the German Guard Reserve Division said the Somme was the muddy grave of the German army. I agree with him. It's a striking phrase, which sums up the brutal arithmetic of this terrible battle. British and Dominion casualties total 420,000, of whom 127,000 were killed. French losses were 200,000, killed, missing and wounded. Estimates of German losses vary between 500 and 600,000. Despite holding all the advantages of defence over attack, their losses were almost as great as the Allies. And this proved crucial to the outcome of the war. The key figure in the German high command, Erich Ludendorff, declared that his armies could not withstand another Somme. Britain had to be tackled another way. 6 weeks after the battle ended, Germany resumed the high-risk strategy of unrestricted U-boat warfare, that is, sinking neutral shipping. This tipped the balance and brought America into the war. From then on, for Germany, it was simply a matter of how long defeat could be postponed. The effect on the Allied war effort was equally significant. The Somme was where the British Army learned how to fight. The British infantry would fight as the French had learned to do. In fact, as my troops did in the Falklands. Advancing in lines was out. Instead, they moved in what were called blobs, that is, small groups covering each other as they moved forward, in what's known as fire and movement. The army learned to fight what we now call an all-arms battle, with tanks and infantry, gunners and aircraft, all playing an interlocking role. The Somme was a killing ground, but also for the British in particular, a vital training ground. The graves remain as a reminder of what these lessons cost. Could such a thing happen today, with 24-hour news coverage of war, with pictures of thousands of body bags being returned home? Perhaps our concept of what war should be has changed in the last 90 years. But it would be wrong to imagine that the public was kept in the dark about the scale of losses on the Somme.
They could see the lists in the newspapers. They could see the hospital trains unloading in public railway stations. They had relatives and friends at the front. They knew what was happening. They understood that this was a necessary war that had to be won, and to win it, there was a price to pay.
The cost was enormous. But by 1918, the British Army was the best trained, and I would say, the best led army in the field. An army forged on the Somme. An army mighty enough to win the war.